Hi, it's Lab Muffin Beauty Science here, skincare nerd and really lazy person. Today I wanted to talk about some of my most used skincare and makeup products. I haven't done an Empties video in a while, and so I've had a stack piling up, and so I thought I'd share a few
short reviews
of some of these. Let me know what sort of products you want me to review next time. Make sure you hit the subscribe button and the bell if you like videos about beauty science. I'm generally pretty thrifty with my products, and my skin's pretty oily, so I don't end up using a lot of products. That means that I don't end up using up very many products, and so getting empties is a pretty big deal for me. I'm always testing out new products and trying out PR samples, and that means I don't really dip into, I guess, my favorite products all that much. So if I end up using a product completely, it's a pretty big achievement. I found that the products that I tend to use up are the ones that are pretty reliable, and so I know that they work for my skin and they're not going to break me out. And because I am a lazy person, a lot of these are also quite convenient and quick to use as well. So I know that a lot of people say that packaging shouldn't be a big deal, but in terms of convenience, if you're a bit time poor, then for me personally, it's a pretty big deal. If something is a really good product and it's in annoying packaging, unless it's easy to change the packaging, then I'm probably not going to end up using it all that much. Now, quite a few of these are PR samples. I've been blogging since 2011, and I'm pretty thrifty because I have immigrant parents. I usually don't really buy products that are in the same category if I already have one left. And so I have a massive amount of PR samples, more than I could ever use. But these are the ones that out of my stash, I've managed to use up, and clearly that means I must be enjoying them a lot. For reference, my skin is normal slash oily, it's really dehydration prone, and it's really pigmentation prone as well. The first product I've got here today is the Peter Thomas Roth Cucumber De-tox Foaming Cleanser. I still have a little bit left so that I can show you guys the texture. This cleanser is really hydrating, it's got a lot of glycerin in it, it's the second ingredient, and glycerin is probably my favourite ingredient for dehydration prone skin. It's got a lot of gentle surfactants, they're svitarionic or non-ionic. Svitarionic means that it's got two charges that are opposite, so it's got a plus and minus charge. Non-ionic means that it's got no charge. So a quick reminder, surfactants are ingredients that are really good at picking up oil and making it dissolve in water. I talk more about surfactants in a few of my other videos, so like my micellar water video, which I've linked below. So the top ingredients in this product, other than water, are glycerin, cocamidopropyl betaine, sodium cocoamphoacetate, and lauryl glucoside. I think one of the main reasons I use this so much is that it's got this foaming pump top, which means that when you squeeze it, it comes out as a foam, which makes it really easy to spread, and it also makes it really easy to cleanse off afterwards as well. In general, if a cleanser has this foaming pump top, I'm probably going to use it a lot. As well as those top ingredients, it's also got a bunch of plant extracts, so things like papaya, pineapple, and sugarcane, which might have a mild exfoliating effect. But for a cleanser, that's not really what I'm looking for. It's a nice bonus though, but what I'm really looking for is hydrating and effective at cleansing. I also use a double cleansing protocol, so I cleanse with like a balm and then an oil, and then I get into the shower and then I cleanse with this. So if you only cleanse once, this might not be strong enough for your skin. But because my skin is dehydration prone, I find that if I do this double cleansing, then my skin stays a lot more hydrated and it stops it from feeling tight and dried out. The problem with these foaming pump tops though is that to make it work, the cleanser has to be pretty watery. So you can see it's pretty much just water. Well, not just water, but you know what I mean. It has the consistency of water. Or viscosity, if you like scientific words. Use this at parties if you hate having friends. So the problem with this is that because it's already got some water mixed with it, and it foams before, like with a normal cleanser, you just rub it to make it foam, it means that it gets used up a lot faster, which is a pretty big downside if you're trying to save money. The other gripe I have with this product is that it does have the word detox on it. This whole line has the word detox, and the word detox, most scientists hate this word because most of the time if a brand is talking about detoxing, they're talking about it in a really non-scientific way. So getting rid of toxins, which are usually really poorly defined, Detoxing is a legit concept in medicine, but it's not things like drawing toxins out of your body. It's things like actually being poisoned and getting the poison out, or stopping using a particular medication. So yeah, the word detox generally is like a siren in my head to be really cautious about what claims it has. But this is a really nice product despite this. I just wish they'd get rid of the word, really. Next up, I have the Farmacy Green Clean Makeup Meltaway Cleansing Balm. This is a soft, light green balm that's actually a really pretty color. It comes with a really handy spatula to dig out your product. And the spatula's attached to this plastic insert in the lid, so one of those sealing inserts. And I hate taking it off and on, so what I ended up doing was I chucked out the insert and I just shoved the spatula like into the middle of the balm. It's really good at removing makeup, as most cleansing balms are, and the nice thing is that it rinses off really cleanly. It has a kind of peppermint scent. It's pretty mild. It's got a few actives in it. It's got some antioxidants like the Echinacea Green Envy extract, but with cleansing products, I don't really get them for the actives, so I guess again, it's a nice bonus, but it's not one of the main reasons I want a product. Now, this product does contain polyethylene, and a lot of people have asked me if this polyethylene counts as microplastic waste, and the hard answer is I don't really know. So you might know microbeads, which are the scrubbing grains of plastic that you get in a lot of scrubs, but the vast majority of microplastic waste in the environment doesn't come from beauty products. It's from laundering synthetic fabrics and from tires. So with synthetic fabrics, whenever you wash any sort of plastic-based clothing, like polyester and acrylic, tiny fibers break off as your clothes are bashing around inside the laundry, inside the washing machine. And these tiny fibers can't be filtered out by your washing machine filter. And so when all the water washes through your clothes and washes off all the detergent, the water makes its way into the ocean, carrying these tiny fibers along. With tires, on your car and on trucks, when you brake a lot, just with wear and tear really, the tires break down and tiny particles come off onto the road and then blow away into the ocean or go down the drain and eventually go into the ocean. Now, no one really knows exactly what the extent of the impact of microplastics are, but so far with studies, it looks like it's not great for things like fish. But given that the plastic in this and in other cleansing balms is really, really small in size, too small to actually see, it probably won't have the same sorts of effects as larger particles that fish will eat. And because there aren't as many particles in this compared to a scrub, I think the impact on the environment is pretty minimal. I do think it would be nice if they got rid of it and managed to replace it with a non-plastic ingredient. It's mostly in there for thickening rather than scrubbing like a polyethylene normally would be in a scrub. But because the size is so small, and I think the amount is a lot lower as well, then I think the effect is mostly insignificant compared to all of the other contributions. Like I mentioned in the video on coral and sunscreens, I think focusing on the tiny amount of plastic in things like these cleansing balms is kind of like rearranging deck chairs on the Titanic. It's kind of missing the main point, and it's a bit of a not a major concern. The texture of this balm is also really nice. It melts onto your skin quite nicely, and I personally prefer using balms to oils these days because with a cleansing balm, you put it on your face, and then you can step into the shower without worrying about it dripping all over your face, dripping onto your clothes and onto the floor and that sort of thing. It's also a lot easier to transport them from your hand onto your face, so you don't have to like slap your face really fast to get all of the liquid onto there because it only melts when it gets on your face. You don't have to use very much either. It spreads really smoothly and quickly. So yeah, really nicely formulated product. So the Uemura cleansing oil, I've actually used it up and chucked out the bottle. And so this is my new bottle that I'm holding here and showing you guys. It's very new. The one I'm using is the Ultimate Sublime Beauty Cleansing Oil. Uemura started the whole cleansing oil craze about 50 years ago, and they've got a whole bunch of different cleansing oils. I think last time I checked, it was about 6 different oils, and one gets sold about every seconds worldwide. At the time I bought it, this was the newest and fanciest one. It's got a pretty long ingredient list, And it looks like the main oils and surfactants are pretty varied. So for oils, there's corn, there's ethyl hexyl palmitate, which has like a nice glide. It's got caprylic and capric triglycerides, which is the same as MCT oil, so medium chain triglycerides from coconut oil, which is pretty popular in nutrition at the moment. There's also isopropyl myristate, which is not very greasy, and there's also a bit of meadowfoam seed oil as well. There's also a bunch of different surfactants in there as well. They're all gentle and non-ionic, and they have lots of glycerin molecules inside these surfactants. So if they stay on skin, they're going to be quite hydrating as well. They're all polyglycerol esters. And there's also the fact that if you have a mix of surfactants inside a product, it usually means that it's more gentle and these surfactants don't get into your skin and cause prolonged irritation, and it disturbs your skin a bit less as well. Again, I'm really into convenience, and so the pump lid is probably one of the big reasons why I end up using it so much. I sound like the laziest person right now, and that's because I am. This cleansing oil is pretty thick. It's not super thick, so it doesn't feel like it's clogging my pores, but it's thick enough that getting it onto my face, that is not a big issue. I don't end up splashing it everywhere. So this cleansing oil, it dissolves makeup really quickly, it washes off really cleanly, and my skin feels really soft afterwards. And because of that, a lot of the time I don't even bother with a second cleanse when I use this, because my skin just feels really nice and I don't want to, I guess, wreck that feeling. It is a bit pricey, but you don't really need to use all that much. You only need like one pump, half a pump, for me at least, with my particular makeup. And so this one is a solid favorite. I have repurchased it. I will probably continue to repurchase it unless a cheaper one comes along. I bought It's Skin Citron Peeling Gel from Rose Shop. I bought three different peeling gels and this one's been my favorite. It has a really nice refreshing citrus scent. Smells a bit like a cleaning product, which I actually quite like. It works really well in the shower. With my peeling gels, I use them after cleansing, and so usually I'm in the shower. I want to rinse it off in the shower because it's a lot easier than stepping out. Again, lazy. A lot of peeling gels aren't really dense enough. They're a bit too watery to bunch up properly to form those little rolling fibers that do all the physical exfoliation for you. And so a lot of them feel like I'm just rubbing my face with my fingers when I use them in the shower. This one is dense enough that you can feel stuff on your skin. This peeling gel contains 1,200 milligrams of yuzu extract. I'm not really sure what it's meant to be doing there. I assume it's for brightening, and I couldn't find the ingredients list translated online, but there's a similar product from It's Skin, and it looks like the main ingredient for peeling is cellulose. With peeling gels, I found that most of them are kind of similar if they bunch up properly, so I'm actually trying a few more, so I haven't repurchased this, but I would repurchase it if I wasn't finding more peeling gels at the moment. My next empty is the Face Shop Rice Water Bright Lip and Eye Makeup Remover. This is one of the Face Shop's best sellers, and one of the things I notice about it that's different from other ones is that it's one of those eye and lip makeup removers that have the two phases. And with this one, after you shake it, it stays mixed for ages, like it stays mixed for days. So if you really don't like having to shake it all the time, then this is probably the one for you. It has a moderate scent, it's kind of powdery. I'm not a huge fan of the scent, and that's probably the main reason that I'm not planning to repurchase it. One of the other things I really like about this from my convenience laziness point of view is that the lid is really good for opening with wet hands. So the lid has this sort of divot, which means that you can get a really good grip on it. You don't have to worry about closing it too tight. You can easily open it, even if your hands are wet and covered in cleanser. It doesn't sting your eyes. It has a little bit of a residue, but the residue feels more hydrating rather than oily, which is a problem with a lot of other two-phase makeup removers. It's pretty effective. It gets everything I use off, but yeah, overall, pretty good product. Not a huge fan of the scent. This is The Body Shop's Fresh Nude Foundation. I use Barley Vanilla, which is 020, and at the moment my skin is in MAC about an NC20. This is a pretty neutral shade. It's a little bit yellow tinged, which works quite well for my skin, and I'm actually wearing it right now. It's a medium coverage foundation that gives me a pretty dewy finish, but my skin is quite oily. It does move a little bit on my skin throughout the day. I just use this all the time because it's just reliable. When it does move, it's a good enough color match that it doesn't look obvious. It doesn't bunch up a lot as well. It does kind of settle into this line here sometimes. but in general it doesn't move very much. There's quite a few shades, and this one is a really good color match for me. And there's actually a pretty impressive shade selection, especially since the Body Shop mostly doesn't do makeup. It's got SPF 15, but to be honest, you're not really putting on enough foundation to get much SPF coverage with this. To apply it, I use a damp sponge, and that works really well. It's also pretty inexpensive, so it's about $32 in Australia, which is really good for a foundation. I've already repurchased this one. It's got a nice texture, it isn't really silicone-y, it doesn't break me out. It's not particularly long wear, but I don't really need long wear most of the time. So yeah, big fan of this one. So that's it for my empties this time. I hope you enjoyed this video. Make sure you subscribe and hit the notification button if you want to find out more about beauty science. You can also follow me on Instagram for more beauty science tips and myth busting, as well as occasional reviews as well. There's also my blog, which has tons and tons and tons of articles on beauty science. See you next time to nerd out more about beauty.